Do we have another question? Yes.
Thank you. My name is Takina Yakubi. I am the executive director of Afghan Institute of Learning, and we are really working with women and children in area of reproductive health. And I'm trying to see how you take this issue of religion when you have a group of really fanatic religious group in a country, and then also you have the constitution that allows the women's right, human's right, that be implemented. And you have a government that who is a weak, has a weak leadership and will not implement that constitution. And then here you have an opposition group that is a religious, restricted religious leader you have there. How do you take this issue, especially when you see that the women are being violated against their reproductive rights? About maternal child mortality rate is the second highest in Afghanistan, for example. If you come to a country like that, how do you advise them? How do you try to really hold the government accountable for this and to really be backing the woman? Because the woman is just dying there and nobody to protect them. How do you tackle this issue? I'm really interested to learn from you and here, and especially in my country, there is a lot of problem. So my question is that.
Thank you so much. Thank you for that. Norma, would you like to start with?
Sí, en América Latina y el Caribe, que parecerían culturas muy similares.
In American cultures, Latin America, in the Caribbean, that would be something similar, somehow similar cultures.
Y existiendo en la mayoría de ellos, de estos países, constituciones que se declaran, que declaran a los estados laicos.
And they have constitutions that the states are not religious.
El procedimiento y las relaciones que se siguen varían muchísimo.
The procedures and the processes are very different from each other.
Hay países donde las luchas tienen que librarse directamente.
There are countries where you have to fight directly.
No nos garantiza que los logros se acumulen y vayamos siempre en una misma dirección.
There is no guarantee that our achievements are going to be accumulated and that we'll follow the same direction.
Como lo constatamos, por ejemplo, ahora de manera especial en Centroamérica.
Like we can see especially in Central America these days.
Donde los derechos sexuales y reproductivos de las mujeres han sufrido un serio retroceso.
Where the women's rights and the reproductive rights have a setback.
Por eso el movimiento feminista y el movimiento de mujeres en general,
that's why the feminist movement and the women's movement in general,
con nuestras aliadas en el norte,
we're allies of the north,
buscamos impactar en primera instancia en las leyes y políticas públicas a nivel de los estados.
Look to have an impact on the policies of the states.
Pero también en estos espacios supranacionales,
and also in the supranational spaces,
como Naciones Unidas o la Organización de Estados Americanos,
the OAS,
para que se produzca una jurisprudencia,
so that there are a set of laws,
unos mandatos,
mandates,
unas recomendaciones a los
recommendations
estados
to the states and governments,
que nos ayuden en alguna forma,
that would help us somewhat,
para tener herramientas y reclamar a los estados.
Have the tools and do our claims and work to the states and governments.
Esto no es automático.
This is not automatic.
Seguramente esta herramienta la tendremos que usar durante muchos años para alcanzar lo que queremos.
We probably will have to use this tool for many years until we get our results.
Pero soñamos con que el esfuerzo que nosotras hacemos,
but we dream that the effort that we do,
y el que hacen las mujeres asiáticas y africanas,
and that all the women of the world do,
con la solidaridad de las europeas,
with the solidarity of the Europeans,
y de fundaciones prestigiosas,
and the prestigious foundations,
de la academia,
with the academy,
y de las personas realmente comprometidas con los derechos humanos,
and people compromised in human rights,
que podamos avanzar positivamente,
we will go ahead
y no retroceder jamás.
And we'll never go back to what it was before.
Thank you, Norma. Did you want to? Thank you.
Well, I think my answer is part and parcel of the answer about the cultural question, because of course religion is part of culture. You know, I used to, in this country, they always talk about the culture wars, and part of what always bothered me about that is it seems sort of unsubstantial. They're actually fundamentally different religious perspectives, so religious wars I always thought would be more appropriate. But, you know, we have to work in the same way. We work with our partners, you know, figuring out the entry points. We work with the commitments that those governments have made to human rights. And so that in, that has to be the point of the battle. But of course, it is a, you know, these are substantial battles about fundamentally different worldviews. But the fact that governments have agreed to certain human rights commitments, you know, gives both our partners and the center working with them the basis to say, you have committed to a different perspective, and that perspective has to be, you know, realized for your women citizens.
Next question. Yes.
I'm Steve Foster from the Overbrook Foundation. Nancy, I wanted to ask you, Center for Reproductive Rights relatively recently announced that it's out of its strategic planning that it would focus more on human rights as advocacy tools inside the United States. And I'm wondering what that actually means in terms of how your work is different or has changed. And the other thing I was interested in with Norma and both and you, how do you see the relationship between what happens in the US and in Latin America and vice versa in terms of either advancing or repressing reproductive rights advocacy?
So in the strategic plan that the center adopted 3 years ago, we were very clear that we were taking a human rights approach in both our work in the US and globally. And part of that, of course, was a mission commitment to make sure that we were not doing what is very American culturally centric, which is talking about constitutional rights here and talking about human rights overseas. But it was also about making sure that we were using the full toolkit that we use as human rights advocates elsewhere in the world. So fact-finding reports in the United States to bring a spotlight to issues that we may not be able to sue on, but they're important to hold the government accountable. So we did a fact-finding report last year on the conditions under which abortion providers are providing their services, that they are harassed, that they are murdered in the case of Dr. Tiller, that they are under constant both regulatory and physical siege, and that they are in fact human rights defenders who are standing up and making services available to women. And they should be seen in that context and not ostracized and stigmatized. So that gave us an opportunity to talk about the issue and frame the debate differently than, you know, we would be if we were suing. We have a report coming out tomorrow on the Hive, restrictions on public funding for women, and bringing women's stories to the table about that. Again, you know, that case the case was sued and lost back 30 years ago now. Look at Professor Law, who worked on that case. So the Constitution is set. We have to work on that in other ways to bring light to that issue. We're also engaging the United States government in a different way with its own treaty obligations. So we report in the annual reporting to the UN process on how the US is living up to its commitments. So it's broadening the toolkits, and it's bringing a different discussion. We are stuck in a very stale and uninteresting debate here in the United States about whether the Supreme Court in Roe versus Wade, and I'm looking at, you know, Professor Siegel, who's written about this a lot, was that a good or bad decision? You know, did it create the backlash? Should it happen? Well, we have to have a different discussion, which is about why women are suffering under the laws and policies that are happening now in the United States. And talking about that in a different context, I think, brings fresh air into the discussion.
Yes, Linda?
Well, thank you so much for this very interesting discussion about the work of both of your centers. So, Nancy, earlier you mentioned something about that it's women who are pregnant who are responsible for caring and delivering children. But really, I think you were also alluding to the fact that it's really everyone's responsibility to raise the next generation and to lead to the production and ongoing nature of society. And a number of us have been talking about the importance of working with men and reaching out to men in terms of public education, in terms of being stakeholders. It's true, women hold up half the sky and probably a little bit more, but that's only half. So I'm wondering if both of you could talk a little bit about how you are engaging men at various levels in your own work. Thanks.
Norma, did you want to start with that?
Muchas gracias.
Thank you very much.
Claden ha decidido desde cuando se adelantó la cumbre de derechos humanos en Viena.
Claden, since the Vienna summit started.
Sí, convocar a una serie de aliados para que comprendan y apoyen nuestro trabajo.
Put together a series of allies to support our work.
En este sentido, consideramos que el movimiento de derechos humanos en su totalidad es nuestro aliado.
We consider that the human rights, all of it, is our ally.
Pero también movimientos afroamericanos
But
y de pueblos originarios.
Movements of African countries and originary peoples.
Que han vivido discriminaciones muy grandes y que afectan de manera especial sus vidas.
That have lived experiences of discrimination that have affected their lives.
Pueden desarrollar sensibilidades frente a nuestras propuestas.
Can develop sensitivities to our proposals.
Por eso cada vez más buscamos que nuestros informes sombras.
That's why we look at our reports
en relación con cinco tratados,
in relation to five treaties,
cuatro ante Naciones Unidas y uno ante la OEA,
four to United Nations and one to OAS,
sean construidos colectivamente,
should be built collectively,
o por lo menos respaldados una vez que los presentamos,
or should be backed once we present them.
Este diálogo contribuye a crear puentes.
This dialogue contributes to create bridges
entre movimientos
between movements
que históricamente se han desarrollado independientemente
that historically has been separated
pero que vamos confluyendo
but we all are getting together
porque la lucha por los derechos humanos como usted bien lo dijo
because the human rights
debe ser de todos y de todas.
It's a fight for everyone, men and women.
Y cada quien debe ser capaz de sentir el dolor, la discriminación y las angustias que viven los otros.
And each one of them should feel the pain, discrimination and the anguish that the others feel.
Una vez que las mujeres logramos tener confianza en nosotras mismas,
once we women achieve trust and in ourselves.
Estamos desarrollando la fuerza para trabajar en conjunto con otros y otras.
Confidently, we are ready to work with the rest.
Sí. La maternidad, en definitiva, es una función social.
Maternity is a social function.
Thank you, Nora. I want to add, follow up with Nancy. Do you find that other progressive human rights social movements take up this cause?
Well, yes, my answer to the question about the men question is that we work to both mainstream and to educate. So a lot of times when we're working with human rights bodies, when we began doing work with the Inter-American Commission for Human Rights, the commissioners were overwhelmingly and maybe at one point exclusively male, and we would bring these issues to them again and again with briefings and materials and background and framing. So that's the sort of education piece. The mainstreaming piece is it's been a major goal of the center to get mainstream human rights organizations to take on the issue of women's reproductive rights as well. And we have been delighted that in recent years, really in the last 6 years or so, Human Rights Watch has taken on working on reproductive rights issues, including abortion rights. Amnesty International has taken on working on these issues. So getting reproductive rights issues onto the agenda of mainstream human rights organizations, what I mentioned, the Human Rights Law Network in India, that was a group that leading experts on human rights, leading practitioners in the Indian Supreme Court, but they hadn't worked on reproductive rights issues before. And so again, Louisa Cabal and I went and met with them and got reproductive rights interested in onto the agenda. So mainstreaming and education, education and mainstreaming.